Thank you, Theodore Darrenbaum. I'm an economist, but in my defense, I follow your opinion about them and read Shakespeare instead of the economists. First question, in a lot of your books, and in the last one, the title says it all, The Knife Went In. Mm-hmm. You're talking about responsibility, the ability of response, which is always the individual's ability of response. We see in the newspapers that the plane exploded, the gun killed, the knife went in. Yep. Is it getting worse in terms of culture to evasions, that you have a book about evasions in psychology? Is it getting worse? And if it is getting worse, why is that, and what can we do to change it?
Well, I don't know whether it's getting worse. If I say yes, it might be because I think everything is getting worse. I've reached the age at which I think everything is getting worse. But it's conceivable that it's getting worse. And one of the reasons for that is that we are very sentimental, actually, and we want people who have misfortunes to be victims, so that people are the victims of their own behavior. And we encourage people to think of their behavior as a victim. As victimhood. So the knife went in, which incidentally the reason it's called The Knife Went In, at my book, which is a memoir of a prison, is that practically every murderer that I met who had killed with a knife, when asked what had happened, to ask described events, said the knife went in. They all said that. As if it was the knife that guided the hand rather than the hand that guided the knife. And there were many other examples of that kind of thing. For example, when I asked heroin addicts, we had an increasing number of heroin addicts. It's now decreasing again for reasons that nobody really knows. But we had a large number of heroin addicts. And when I asked the heroin addicts why they had started, they all said, practically all said, I fell in with the wrong crowd. They just happened to meet the wrong kind of people. And I would say to them, you know, it's very funny, I meet many people who fell in with the wrong crowd, but I never meet any member of the wrong crowd itself. And they all laughed. They all knew immediately what I was saying. Now, I'm sorry, I'm going on a little bit now.
No.
The fact is that to become a heroin addict in British and European circumstances, it required people to, well, in fact, this is what they did. They took heroin on and off for about 18 months before they became physically addicted. And when you think about what they actually had to do to become addicted, they had to learn where to get the heroin, how to prepare it, how to inject it. Most people have an inhibition against injecting themselves intravenously. Most people wouldn't want to do it. When you take all this into consideration, it's perfectly obvious that they wanted to be heroin. This was something that they sought to be. And yet these obvious considerations make absolutely no impact at all on the way we think about heroin addiction, either in the United States or in Western Europe. For us, well, in fact, officially speaking, heroin addiction on the National Institute of Drug Abuse in the United States is a chronic relapsing brain disorder. And that's all it is. No other explanation about it whatsoever. And partly that, of course, is because they want a technical answer to the problem. Because that is the only way that Congress will disperse any money. If there's the prospect of a technical solution to this problem, Congress will give them more and more money. But if they say, well, actually, it's a complex problem, and it's spiritual and educational and economic and all the other things, Congress would not give the National Institute of Drug Addiction any money. So I think there is, if you like, cultural tendency to try and turn people's self-destructive behavior, bad behavior, into an illness. And you might be interested to know the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of the American Psychiatric Association, which unfortunately is taken almost as a Bible by psychiatrists and also judges. If you work out the prevalence, it means that on average, everyone has 2.5 psychiatric illnesses, disorders every year. And almost everything, even faking illness is now an illness. So you can't fake illness, but if you fake illness, it's an illness. So almost everything is. So we do tend to take responsibility away from people, yes.
Okay. Do you think that the wealth made the West coward, as Adam Smith, for example, predicted it would? And how can we fight Islam, for example, that is a huge problem in Europe, if people are such cowards nowadays and afraid of the victims' revolution and to offend other people? How will we fight Islam and survive?
Well, I mean, if you take the question of Islam, the only way, obviously, in my view, is actually to counter the claims of Islam. And to examine it in a way that actually the Bible was examined and in certain ways found wanting. But this we don't do, and it's largely cowardice, I think, because people who do criticize Islam, even in a scholarly way, feel threatened. And so we're just frightened. And I know, for example, I rent a flat in Paris, and our neighbours are leaving Paris because they're afraid of, well, one of the reasons, it's not the only reason, but one of the reasons is that the atmosphere has changed because of Islamic terrorism. And we see in this very peaceable and quite prosperous quarter of the city is patrolled by the army. Now that's a very easy thing to do. I'm not at all reassured by patrols of the army in the street, because they make themselves targets for one thing. And I also wonder whether one day one of those soldiers is going to go mad himself and start shooting people in the street. But this is a kind of easy way to try and deal, a cowardly way to deal with the problem. And the real way to deal with it, I think, is to be completely frank and open about the deficiencies of Islam, actually from the very beginning. But I don't see much prospect of that happening.
You have a saying in British that the nurture and nature, and yep, it's culture and institutions. You're not a religious guy, I'm not a religious person either, but I think we both share the legacy of Christianity in terms, in a positive way, in terms of what the West became. Do you think that there is a spiritual disease, as you mentioned? Do you think that the death, the so-called death of God, has something to do with it, that people are only materialists now and hedonists, and is that a problem in your way?
I think the desire for transcendence, for some kind of purpose beyond oneself, is certainly very common in people above a certain level of development. In Europe, religion is more or less dead, certainly in France and Britain. More or less dead, except in Islam, unfortunately. There's no transcendent political project. The European Union certainly can't be it. It's just a bureaucratic monster, and people can't feel any great interest in it. They've been how could I say, they've been cut off from their own historical cultures. So that in France, for example, I've noticed that the youth have comparatively little interest in French literature. And in England, it's practically nil. I remember one patient, young patient, I was trying to find out what he'd learned in school, other than how to deal in drugs and things. And I was trying and testing him, and I said, who was Shakespeare? And thought, and he said, the name rings a bell. And this is, as I pointed out this morning, this is after an education that has cost $80,000 on average. And so they don't have any feeling of contributing to a continuing culture from which at least I derive a certain amount of feeling of transcendence.
Yeah.
I don't have any feeling of personal transcendence, but I feel a purpose. There is no purpose. And they many of them don't believe in they don't believe in the possibility of economic improvement. Not that I think that's a particularly important thing. They don't have any families, so there's no transcendence through a family. The family is, in my area, was completely destroyed. Absolutely completely. I mean, when I tell people that in my hospital, with the exception of Indian immigrants, or people of Indian descent, I should say, the illegitimacy rate was 100%. It was almost unknown for a child to live with his father and his mother, and certainly not for very long.
Yeah, actually, it would be my next question. You talked a lot about the intelligentsia there. Communicating class in your keynote speech, and you have a lot of books about it. I have a best-selling book in Brazil, which I mentioned you a lot, called Esquerda Caviar, Liberal Libres, in our Gauche Caviar. And the people that suffer from the ideas of this intelligentsia, which destroy the families and all that, is the poor people usually. The coming apart thesis of Charles Murray. I remember, if I remember correctly, I read in one of your books that almost 50% of the poor people in London never had a dinner or a lunch with the family.
Yeah,
so how can you raise people like that?
I don't know. It's not 50%. It's 20%.
Okay. It's still a lot.
Yeah. It's still a lot. And I used to get into their houses, and they would have... There would be no sign of anyone ever having cooked. They didn't cook. The only instrument they had was the microwave oven to heat up pre-cooked meals. And they didn't eat together unless it was in front of the television. And when you think of how elementary the training is, of eating together, and you, as a child, you learn how to share things with other people, how you wait for things. You sometimes have to eat when you're not hungry, and sometimes you can't eat when you are hungry. You have to learn discipline, and you learn that your own state is not a state of desire, is not the only consideration as to how you behave. All that, this is very elementary. But all that is completely destroyed in quite a large part of British society. It's worse in Britain than any other country in Europe, partly, of course, because the culinary tradition is so bad anyway. But what you hear from sociologists and so on is that there is a food desert in the areas where these families live. There's nowhere where they can go and get vegetables and so on and so forth. Well, the reason there's nowhere for them to get vegetables is because they they wouldn't know what to do with them anyway. And where the Indians are, where in people of Indian descent are, vegetables are so abundant that you can hardly carry away the amount, and they're very cheap, you can hardly carry away all that you can buy for £10. And these people spend more than £10 on a single meal that is prepared. Now, this is obviously, to me, this is obviously not just an economic problem. It's a problem of ideas about how people should live. And coming back to your original point, the interesting thing is that marriage is common, and more common as you ascend the social scale. So the very people who propounded the ideas that divorce should be easy, that marriage doesn't matter, and so on and so forth, are the very people who actually abide more by the old ideas than the ideas that the intelligentsia of that class propounded.
Yeah. And one last question about pride. Your books, your new book talk about pride. You have, I guess, 14 or 15 year experience in prison. So, did the left get it all wrong? They talk about economy and inequality as causes of violence and crime. They don't care about what we are talking about here, family, how we raise our kids, divorce, and all that. And they think that the public education is the solution for that all. And as you mentioned, it's not working. So what should we do to decrease crime in society? And if the left got it all wrong?
Well, the left did get it all wrong, of course. And actually, from a purely conceptual point of view, it would be much easier to reduce crime in Britain than in Brazil. Because, of course, Brazil is, things are very bad in Britain, in my opinion, but of course they're not nearly as bad as in Brazil. And we have about 600 murders a year. Our population is a third of yours, so it would amount to 1,800 murders if you had the same rate as Britain, and that's very different from 64,000 or whatever it was. In Britain, the solution would be, in my view, is very simple, conceptually. And that is that people should go to prison for much longer than they do, because I don't want to go into the statistics too much, but it's easy to show that a very high proportion of crime, even now in Britain, is committed by a very small percentage of the population. And the state, for many, many years, has refused to incapacitate those people as if it had many other things to do. I mean, there are many peculiarities. Left-wing people think that criminals are kind of Robin Hood figures. But the people who suffer from crime are the poor. They're not rich. I don't suffer from crime. But if I lived in an area of public housing, my life would be dominated by the fear of crime. And in our prisons, we have quite a lot of people in our prisons. People often say that we have a higher rate of imprisonment. We have a very low rate of imprisonment by comparison with the amount of crime we have. And people say, left-wing people say, that we imprison people unnecessarily. But actually, 50% of our prisons, 70% have been convicted at least 7 times, and 50% 15 times or more. Now, when you consider that each of those persons has committed, on average, 10 or 15 times more crimes than he's ever been accused of, you can see that these people are, and they get very short sentences. Not only do they keep coming back into prison, and keep being found guilty again. But they serve very short sentences, which is very cruel, because they don't, short sentences are useless. And it's the same people also being victimized over and over again. So those who say that we are being harsh with our criminals have absolutely no idea what they're talking about. I don't suppose they've ever met a criminal, actually, apart from a politician. But so in fact, in England, it would be very, conceptually, but not politically easy. There are many things which are conceptually easy to do, but which are for various reasons, usually the opposition of bien pensant intellectuals, are very difficult to do. Now, Brazil is a is another
tougher problem.
a tougher problem, and I wouldn't want to suggest that you take the Liechtenstein solution or Luxembourg's solution. Someone, I think this morning, asked me whether I thought the tougher penalties for murderers in Brazil would do very much, and I don't know what is the average prison sentence for a murderer.
It's really short in Brazil.
How
if you kill someone, you're supposed to stay maximum 30 years, and you can get out 1/6 of that.
So 5 years.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's nothing.
Yeah. Right. I mean, I think it would be. Personally, I think people should go to prison much longer than that.
If you are under 18, 2 years maximum, you are out to do it again. I said it was the last question. I have one more. In your books, we can see that you always told the truth to your patients in prison.
Yes.
And I don't think it's what usually doctors do, because they think that it's human to play the victimhood. The society is to blame. They feel that it's humane to take away the guilt,
yes,
of the prisoner. It's the opposite, isn't it?
Well, I think so, because it seemed to me anyway that you could only respect people. The only way you could respect people was by telling them the truth. And interestingly, I never said anything in my books that I didn't actually say to the prisoners, and using the same language. And another thing that used to be said about prisoners was that they were unintelligent. And they were very badly educated, that was certainly true. But that's not the same as being unintelligent. And the language that I'm using with you now is precisely the language that I would have used with the prisoners, and they have absolutely no difficulty in understanding it whatsoever. Now, that might be, of course, because what I say is very simple-minded and very not very intelligent. But of course, I dismissed that hypothesis. So, in other words, I think they were condescended to by people who try to disguise their responsibility for their...
They feel contempt for them, and it's...
Yes, there's this sentimental view that you have to turn people into victims before you try and do anything for them. Now, if, as it says in Hamlet, treat each man after his desert, and who should escape whipping? That is to say, if everyone got his deserts, we'd all be in prison, because we've all done something wrong. So actually, although I'm not religious, the Christian understanding is actually much deeper than the sociological, criminological, economic understanding.
Agree. They gave us a few more minutes, one more question. Do you think that aesthetics and moral relativism are related in any way? And are people afraid of the beauty, the concept of beauty? And why is that? Do you think that's because they feel their mediocrity when they have to face something superior or something better?
Well, certainly there was a very beautiful essay by a man called Simon Lees, who thought that Philistines actually know very well what beauty is, and they fear it because it confronts them with their own nullity. As to the relationship between moral and aesthetic relativism, I think the difficulty is that we all feel that we want a metaphysical metaphysical point, a metaphysical theory that will make our aesthetic judgments, our aesthetic and moral judgments, true beyond any possible doubt. So what we want actually is a kind of Cartesian point of cogito from which we can justify our aesthetic and moral principles. And in fact, I don't think, well, unless I've missed something in philosophy, I'm not a philosopher, I don't know, but I don't think there is such a Cartesian point, and that makes us doubt absolutely everything. And once you start doubting everything, certainly in the aesthetic field, the worst and the easiest always triumphs over the good. So there's a kind of Gresham's law, bad currency drives out good.
And it's a career escape for the mediocrity people to do that. I promise that it's the last one. I would stay here the whole day, but you're tired and we have to end it. One of the best essays that I wrote from you was the Rasselas against the candid, Voltaire candid way of thinking. You said that the Samuel Johnson's Rasselas is much more mature and profound. And so just wanted the opportunity for you to explain that.
Well, Candide, I'm sure you've all read, is directed at a particular kind, a particular doctrine that all is for the best, in all the best in, of all possible worlds. And this is something that I don't think anybody really believes now. And therefore, the point of it is rather lost. And I think there's actually something rather adolescent about the whole book. Dr. Johnson's Rasselas, or Dr. Johnson's Rasselas, and you probably, I'm sure you don't, most of you don't know it, the book, its fundamental message is that there is no perfect life for man on earth, that dissatisfaction is the permanent condition of mankind, and oddly enough, once you realize that, it has a consolatory effect. Although it sounds a very pessimistic view, it's actually, it consoles you, because you then cease seeking for a utopia, and you can accept the dissatisfactions of life more easily. And actually the book ends rather in a postmodern way. The last chapter is called Conclusion, in which nothing is concluded. And so, and this is a book which I think will be true of all human life until human life becomes extinct. Whereas Voltaire's book is aimed at a target which is no longer very interesting.
True enough. There's a liberation feeling when you accept the limitations of our life. Okay, Daribal, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it. I hope the people in the audience appreciate it too. Thank you very much.
Thank you.